long time ago, a very long time ago, a very, very, very long time ago, when I was a little kid, I grew up on the south side of Chicago. In those days, that was a very safe world. Almost as soon as we could walk, the city was ours. Without parental supervision, we'd take the bus, the L, and go downtown. We'd roam around the parks. It was completely safe. But there was a fair amount of fistfights that went on among the guys. Now, I have to confess I was in some. But I also have to confess I was never in a fight where I didn't end up on the ground, blood pouring out of my nose, and me crying. But there were some guys who were pretty good with their fists. I remember a summer afternoon we were playing softball, and as sometimes happens in a game, an argument broke out. And one kid who was always kind of a bully went up to a friend of mine and sucker punched him right in the nose. And my friend looked at him and laughed. Now, he didn't say, "Is that your best shot?" But his body language said, "Look out, kid." And he proceeded to pulverize that guy who had punched him. Now, you might be wondering about now, why is our bishop talking about fist fights and pulverizing an enemy? And I'll tell you the reason. Jesus Christ is our conquering, triumphant Messiah. If you listen for these 40 days of Lent, especially these days of awe during Holy Week, our Lord did not lose his life. He freely gave it up. Now, he suffered truly. It wasn't pretend. But he did it willingly for our salvation. He knew what it was to be betrayed by a friend when his friend Judas basically turned him into the police. He was arrested and bound by those temple police and beaten. And then he was interrogated by the high priest. Jesus, who was forever Lord, was interrogated by the priest who served at his altar. Then he was handed over to a petty pagan procurator who dared to ask him about kingship and about truth. Jesus, who as God, reduced archangels into trembling by his merest glance, that he submitted to them. Then he was brutally scourged. He was handed his cross, which he carried to Calvary. He was nailed to that cross, and for 3 hours he suffered. And then he was taken down and put in the tomb, and they rolled an enormous rock in front of him. And his enemies thought he was beaten. Remember in the Creed we confess every Sunday, he was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. Now, what in the world does that mean? It's really a translation for he descended into Sheol, the land of the dead. He truly, as man, experienced death. The ancient fathers of the church tried to imagine what that was like. They called it the hallowing of hell. That light which is greater than all other lights, that light that is brighter than all the stars, went to the realm of our enemy, Satan, sin, and death. And Adam and Eve, our first parents, saw their descendant and came up to him weeping. And he led those holy souls out of hell into a greater paradise than Eden, into the paradise of heaven. Again, the fathers of the church compared him to a conquering charioteer who ties his enemy behind him and drags him around the stadium. Christ was victorious. Christ was glorious. He won for us an unsurpassable victory. And that's why this night, the elect, those who are to be baptized are here. They will be born again through water and the Holy Spirit. That is why this night, those who seek full communion with the Catholic Church will be received by the Church and confirmed. That is why all of us, remembering the promises once made at our baptism and confirmation, rejoice without restraint. If you aren't smiling tonight, if you don't belt out your hallelujahs till your throat is sore, there is something wrong with you. The Lord has won. He has conquered sin and death. He offers us a share in his sonship with the Father. He pours out his Holy Spirit to live in our hearts and lives. We already have one foot in heaven, and our salvation is assured. Brothers and sisters, Christ is risen. He is truly risen, and his Church rejoices tonight without any restraint.